Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Bostino's Think Canada for Your Expansion, a powerhouse of AI innovation. My name is Carolyn Jones, and I'm the market president and publisher of the Boston Business Journal and Bostino. Everyone at the Boston Business Journal and Bostino is thrilled to host today's program in partnership with the General Consulate of Canada, and we appreciate all you joining us for what promises to be a jam-packed morning. You know, Canada has become a powerhouse of AI innovation, producing the most AI patents per capita among G7 nations between 2015 and 2018, more than China even. And today's discussion will dive into growth, investing, and much more. For those of you who might not be familiar with Bostino, it's a news and event platform dedicated to covering startups and innovation in Greater Boston. It's the sister news outlet to the Boston Business Journal and is also part of American Inno, which is a network of sites in 45 markets and growing that catalyzes innovation nationwide. At Bostino, we work to connect innovators in a couple of ways. First and foremost is The Beat, a newsletter that goes out every weekday and a one-stop shop for everything going on in Boston's startup and innovation scene. You can sign up for The Beat by going to bostino.com, where you'll also find original coverage on up-and-coming startups, fundraising, ecosystem trends, and more. And of course, we connect entrepreneurs through events like this one, hopefully some in person sometime soon. Before we begin the program, just a couple of housekeeping items. Attendees do have camera access throughout the whole program, as always, but you do have the option to turn your camera off if you'd like to at any time. Just use that camera icon at the bottom panel and click Stop Camera. Uncheck it to reactivate it. You don't need to have your camera on or to use the chat function, but the chat is a great way to take advantage of some of the interaction that you might do with other attendees. If you do have a question or need something from us during the program, just use that chat to message the host directly. That's Megan Sherman, our events director. We have the chat box open, so if you'd like to stir up a conversation, ask a question for the whole audience, or perhaps with an individual member, you can use the chat box or the direct chat to do that. We do encourage you to create some buzz today around the program, as always, and share it on your social media platform. So please use the hashtag InnoAI. That's InnoAI. And hosting events such as today's program, of course, would not be possible without our partner, the General Consulate of Canada, who is the driving force behind today's conversation and topic. Thanks to them for their continued support and for making today's program possible. So to help kick off today's program, I'd like to invite Roger Kuzner, Consul General of Canada in Boston, to join me and say a few words. Roger, welcome, and over to you.
Thank you very much, Carolyn, and it's been great getting to know you over the last few days. You and Megan have been so helpful with this event and pulling it together. I'd like to welcome everybody on the call today and thank Boston Business Journal and Bostino for partnering with us for today's forum. I'm certainly looking forward to it, as well as future collaboration in this area. The Government of Canada has invested considerably in recent years in AI research and commercialization through the Pan-Canadian AI strategy and our key ecosystems in Edmonton, Toronto, and Montreal. In Canada, we're committed not just to the research, but to taking that success out of the lab and into the world. We now have well over 1,000 companies, startups in Canada, including unicorns like Hopper and Applyboard. Another investment success story through our superclusters is Scale AI, and I know that Julian Bio will be speaking with us in a few minutes, and I very much look forward to that. We also have Sophia on the panel today, which is an example of a really cool, young, dynamic company that we've been able to help expand into Canada, where they recognized there's a wealth of incredible and affordable talent that will allow them to grow and thrive. We know that, as everybody on the call knows, investment follows talent, and that's a resource that we believe in Canada we are deep in. I just want to mention two things. First, if there's something that you see or hear today that catches your interest, something that you think might benefit your business or add to the success of your enterprise, we want to hear from you. Caroline McCaffrey and Chris Begley key members of our trade team at the consul office. They're both in the audience today. Both are smart, experienced, highly motivated professionals. They're there to help in any way they can. They certainly want to succeed in helping you succeed. Or contact myself directly. I'd look forward to that as well. Finally, I was just at game four on Tuesday night at Fenway. Ninth inning, tied game. The ump, Laz Diaz, who's I'm sure is a fine man in his own right. He made a call that was questioned by 40,000 people on hand and the millions more watching at home. Now, with the intellectual capacity and creative horsepower that's on this call today, I'm confident that AI might be able to come to the rescue of the grand old game. I understand Boston fans are the best sports fans maybe in the world, but and I'm not just, pumping your tires. It's a fact. But when I saw the guy in front of me hurl a fully loaded ballpark Frank at poor Laz's direction, that the guy just paid $10 for it. I figured it's time for AI to step in and help the game out. So without further ado, again, to Carolyn, to the folks at the Business Journal, thanks so much for partnering today, and I look forward to the presentations. Thank you.
Terrific. Roger, thank you. What a great story, and we could have used a little AI last night maybe, but on to Houston. So we'll keep the faith, but I'm with you there. But thank you for that great opening. And really thanks to you and everyone at the General Consul of Canada for your partnership. And as Roger mentioned, we encourage all of you, any of you, to connect with the folks there. If you need any info to connect with them, be sure and let us know and we can make that introduction. We'll see you in just a couple of minutes, Roger, for our panel discussion. And today's conversation will be a deep dive on how you can start thinking about cross-border expansion, scale, and the many resources that Canada has to offer high-growth companies looking to expand internationally. AI, as Roger said, is a transformative and can be a transformative technology with potential impact across all sectors of the economy, even baseball. Around the world, businesses are using AI to respond to a wide range of business needs for forecasting, predicting consumer needs, and communication. This terrific panel will be able to give perspectives from all different areas. So now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our moderator and our panelists for today's conversation. Moderating today's discussion is our own Sam Mintz, our reporter for Bostino. Sam actually joined the BBJ and the Inno team about a month ago, and we're thrilled to have him with us. He comes from a great background covering business and many other issues, so we look forward to a lot more from Sam, so thank you. Joining Sam for today's discussion is Julian Biu, the CEO of Scale AI, Roger Kuzner, of course, the Consul General of Canada in Boston, Vish Punwani, CEO of Sophia, Tom Ryden, the Executive Director of Mass Robotics. And stepping in on the panel, we have Chloe Holzinger, Investment Associate at The Engine, Delcy Madden, unfortunately, who was going to be part of today, had a last minute conflict, but Chloe was kind enough to join us. So welcome to all of you, and thanks for joining us. And Sam, I'm gonna hand it over to you.
Great. Well, again, thank you so much for being here with us. I'm really excited to have you all here. I don't plan to do a lot of talking. We've got some great experts here who I think are way more interesting to hear from me. And although I do want to catch up with Roger about the MLB officiating and how we can work on fixing that. But just to start things off, I really would love to hear from some of you about why Canada is an AI hub, why the case, and why companies might be starting to looking to move there or expand there. And I was hoping maybe we could start with Julian and tell us a little bit about what makes Canada a unique place when it comes to AI innovation and research and what you guys are doing at Scale.
Good morning, everybody, and thanks, Sam, for this introduction. Well, basically, as one of the five Canadian superclusters, I have obviously great things to say about Canada as a place to do AI. So just two words about Scale AI. So Scale AI is one of the five Canadian superclusters. Our goal is to facilitate AI introduction into the supply chain industry by basically funding projects. So usually we fund between 40% and 50% of the cost of your projects in AI. We are an initiative from the federal government, also supported by the government of Quebec, and we are located in Montreal. So I would argue about the best fan in the world, but obviously, you know, the Habs fan are definitely the best in the world, and specifically when we talk to Boston. So aside of that, Canada is a great place to invest because we have a great ecosystem. I think for me, the key word here is ecosystem. And when you think about ecosystem, you have to think about, first of all, fundamental research, because every innovation is beginning in fundamental research. Every great workforce is beginning with education. So fundamental research, education, that's a critical piece for Canada. But you have also a great ecosystem for startups with great acceleration and incubation program in Montreal, actually hosting some of mentors coming from Boston, like Tony Chan usually. And we have a great system to fund projects, merging and linking industry to startups, like what we do at Scale AI. So I don't want to take too much time. I'll come back to that, but definitely, I would say Canada has a great ecosystem, both in Montreal, Edmonton, and Toronto, linking industry to startups and fundamental research. That's why it's a great place to invest and to do AI.
So having heard from the Canadian side, I'd love to hear from some of the folks in Boston, you know, Vishal, Tom, or Chloe, about sort of what you're seeing and why you're advising companies or moving your own companies to expand in Canada, whoever wants to jump in.
So I'll go ahead and start. So just a little bit about Mass Robotics. We're a nonprofit located in Boston that supports the robotics and AI community. We also run an innovation center that houses 65 startups, which I think three or four Canadian. And so we do a lot of work across border. I'm always impressed at the number of startups in the particular areas we focus in that are in Canada. And I know Roger and Julian mentioned a couple areas. We see tremendous growth in Vancouver, as an example. You know, a lot of our autonomous, what we call autonomous mobile robots or robots that can navigate by themselves using a combination of sensors and AI. A lot of that work is done in Vancouver, in Quebec, in Montreal, and there's some great small clusters. There's companies that are, you know, we work with a lot of startups in those areas, and I'm impressed at how much both support they get from the ecosystem, as Julian mentioned, and from the government. You know, Quebec's, I think, invested over $100 million in their AI cluster. So we're seeing a lot of major investments and support for startups. So, you know, echoing what Julian said, it's a great opportunity for companies to get started in Canada.
Yeah, and I'll go next. So my name is Chloe Holzinger. I'm dialing in from the Engine in Cambridge, Massachusetts. We invest in pre-seed, seed, and Series A startups pursuing tough tech solutions to global problems in climate, human health, and supply chains. And, you know, although we only really invest in companies based in the US and specifically Massachusetts-based companies, we do also do a lot of work with companies in Canada. Since, you know, the more that Canada does to foster technology innovation and research in AI and other tough tech areas, really, we think the better off we'll be. And so we work with, you know, groups at Vector Institute and Creative Destruction Labs and the University of Waterloo in order to stay really up to date with really the cutting edge research in AI and ML. We do twice a year, we do this blueprint program where we foster potential entrepreneurs who are thinking about spinning out from academia and establishing their own tough tech startup. And this year, in our most recent cohort, we did have one representative from the University of Waterloo who was looking to commercialize a biodegradable material for packaging. And so we do try to maintain, you know, special relationships between the Engine and Boston's particular ecosystem with the innovation ecosystems in Canada, since, you know, the research areas there are so cutting edge and top of class.
And Vishal, if you want to talk a little bit about sort of your journey with the and the relationship between Boston and Canada with your company.
Sure. Yeah. And let me just apologize in advance. We just got a puppy. So if something comes flying at me from like one side, you'll know that I'm not okay. So Sophia started in Boston at Harvard's Innovation Labs in 2019. That's kind of when we sort of began our machine learning for education journey. My background and my co-founder's background, we used to be two of the top teaching fellows at Khan Academy. And some of the complaints we would hear from students all around the world was, man, like we use really good AI various algorithms to help us listen to music better with Spotify, or buy things in a better way using Amazon or whatever, or like know who to not listen to or which family member to kind of like put aside on Facebook. Just kidding. And for education, no such thing really exists. And so what we set out to do was tackle that problem. And the funny thing is that mid-2020, things were very, very locked down in Boston, at least in Fenway where I lived. And because I had Canadian citizenship, and I've been hearing all these stories about how Vancouver is really, really beautiful, and there weren't as many restrictions, my co-founder and I, who's also Canadian, we said, hey, why don't we look into establishing a subsidiary over there? There's a bunch of talent that, you know, was at UBC or BCIT or SFU and all the different technical institutes here, as well as on the island, UVic, Camosun, you know, all the different colleges. There's these young folks who are more and more skewing toward computer science and statistics and math. And so we thought, okay, well, it might be a really good idea to go and set up shop there, given the different tax credits and talent that's available in Vancouver, as well as the ecosystem. And I'm sure we'll talk about that a little bit more later in this call. And so once we had like decided to take the plunge and come to Vancouver, and Carolyn McCafferty and Chris King were very, very helpful in helping us do that. I think Carolyn's in the audience, so thank you so much, Carolyn. We actually underwent like a major pivot, and it didn't really have anything to do with the business. It had to do with everybody going remote. So we pivoted away from our sort of machine learning for education business, and we started building a metaverse for workplace. And so if anybody's ever seen, you know, what's happening with Facebook and Horizons, Facebook's actually planning to rebrand their entire company apparently this next week or something like that to do with metaverse. We're building a solution in that space, and the ways in which we're applying different sort of subdomains of AI. Happy to talk about that as well in this call. But yeah, that's kind of what's happening now. And that was our transition over. And there's more subtlety there that I think from a practical level, it'd be good to get into a bit about how to structure your organization so that you can take full advantage of, you know, links into the network, as well as rebates for research and development, which obviously is germane to an AI discussion.
Really interesting to hear you talk about making that transition during the pandemic, because one of the things that I was hoping to ask all of you about was sort of the challenges that have come with the border closures and the international travel issues, which are, you know, constantly changing, shifting over the last few years. And I'd love to hear about sort of how some of you who do work cross-border have handled that. And maybe we can go back to you for just a minute, Vishal, and I'd love to hear more about your experience handling the challenges there, and sort of why you made the decision to move in the midst of that challenge.
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, for us, we are and every company is different, right? So like, it may not necessarily be the same for others who were at our stage, and our stage meaning we were at like seed stage when we moved, right? And that was pre-pivot. So for us, we had really strong leadership in Boston. So that's about where 85% of our team is still. And so knowing that we had a good set of leaders in Boston who, if anything needed to happen in person, that could happen. And my co-founder and I going to Vancouver to sort of, you know, be pioneers and explore the new frontier of the West Coast of Canada, at least from a building a team perspective. That's why we felt safe to do that. Just because we knew we were covered back home in Boston. I don't think I'm answering your full question though.
No, that was what I was getting at. And you know, I'd love to hear also from Julian and Roger a little bit how you guys have worked to manage that for the companies that you work with, and what some of the challenges were there over the last few years.
Well, basically, you know, typically at Scale AI, we had a program for chairs, actually. And one of the conditions for us to grant a chair to a university was to welcome somebody from abroad, and typically a new hires to increase the talent pool we have in Canada. And obviously, well, COVID made that difficult, meaning it was hard for just candidates to visit the universities. So we saw a great beginning of the program before COVID, but then when COVID hit, it was much more difficult. in a sense that basically people could not travel anymore to just to visit universities and decide whether they would want to move their families. So obviously it was not easy. What we saw in the different, if you think about AI projects globally, we saw that, of course, in the beginning of pandemic, AI project relatively slowed down because companies had other issues to tackle, but then they quickly recover. I would say since summer 2020, so more than a year ago, we saw really a big take, really uptake on in AI projects because companies have understood they need to invest. They need to invest now and do AI now to prepare for recovery or for different issues, because a pandemic has absolutely demonstrated all the issues companies were having, not being enough digitalized or not using AI, and typically in the supply chain industry. Well, we all saw the issues in the supply chain right now, and not having digitalized supply chain is definitely not helping.
You know, Roger, when you're looking at the work that you guys have done during the pandemic, I'd imagine it could apply to many more industries than just AI and startups. But can you tell me a little bit about sort of how you manage the travel challenges and border challenges and all the rest? Oh, looks like we might have lost Roger. Tom or Roger, are you there?
While we're waiting for Roger, just one of the things, most of the companies we deal with have hardware and software, right? The AI drives robotics, but they need the physical hardware. So the pandemic's been certainly a challenge. You know, there's a number of folks who can obviously do their coding and work from afar, but when it actually comes to implementation, they need to be by the robot. So the ability to get to the hardware has been a challenge, especially for some of the smaller startups who have not been able to cross the border and have not been having access. We're starting to see that free up. And then obviously as companies grow, they have multiple platforms. So it's a lot easier. But for a young company, it has been really challenging.
I just want to pause for a second and just note that if you have questions from the audience, we'd love to hear from you. We'd love to involve you in the conversation. We want to know what you're thinking and what you're wondering. So feel free to use the chat function to get in touch and ask questions for any of our panelists or all of them. And Vishal, sorry about that, I interrupted you.
Oh, that's okay. I was just gonna add, ultimately with all of the border restrictions and its effects on, you know, hardware startups or companies in particular, as well as in-person visitations, the way that they used to be. I think somebody mentioned going to universities, maybe that was you, Julian. I think the best part about the pandemic, I don't know who says that, but humor me, is that it forces, like, just think about the ways that we're all thinking now and that billions of people are thinking about problems, right? Like, I think it's so great that people are being much more unconstrained in their thinking about how to solve problems, because it means that we're being pulled away forcibly from paradigms that we maybe just believed in, or just were too, not lazy, but deconditioned from thinking about, right? And so for us, for example, you know, when we were all in Boston, we were all on campus at Harvard, and, you know, there was, I don't know, 13 or 14 of us at the time. And then we kind of all had to leave. We all got kicked out, essentially. And some of us went to Canada, some went to Australia, some went to Europe, one went to India, and then other people went all over the US. And so for us, we were like, okay, well, we're going to try this whole Zoom Slack thing for a little bit. And it just wasn't good for our culture or our communication or anything like that. You know, I think I heard maybe Carolyn Jones, you and Roger, I think, were talking in the pre-show about how, like, it's really hard to just have that spontaneous conversation when you want to walk up to a colleague, poke your head around their office door or whatever and say something. And for us, that was kind of the catalyst behind us creating our new software to help our team to communicate in a much better way. And so now all of a sudden the border issue is a non-issue for us. And like the cross world problem is just not a problem anymore. And so then there's, now we're thinking, okay, well, now how do we apply different machine learning and particular techniques to enable better business communication. And that's like, you know, obviously we don't want to fall down the rabbit hole of like, okay, well, how do you create a solution and find problems for it to solve? But I think that's kind of part and parcel of computer science. It's like, you will run into that sometimes. But Julian, I think you have something to say.
Oh, I would say, and to go to your point, Vishal, I think also in another sense, pandemic has opened some new opportunities, meaning everything has become virtual. If you think about program like Creative Destruction Lab, typically all sessions are virtual. So in a sense, it's much more easy right now to test at least the Canadian ecosystem without moving, in a sense, because you can take advantage of recruiting people that will stay in Canada. You can have access to the best accelerators or incubators in the country, like the Creative Destruction Lab network, both in Vancouver, Toronto, Montreal, or Halifax, virtually. So no need to move. And that's something that was not feasible before, meaning before the pandemic, you needed to move and physically travel to have access to network of experts and knowledge and scientific research. Now you can do that online. And I think we'll keep that online, meaning the reality is post-pandemic, we'll keep a hybrid model because we recognize that for Canada, it's a unique opportunity to attract talent without forcing people to move, at least at the first time. And then obviously, if they like the ecosystem, if they have great business opportunities, if they understand they can hire great people, it's a great way for them then to move physically into the country. So I think this hybrid model, in a sense, was, of course, created by the pandemic and or forced by the pandemic, but it's a kind of a great opportunity that will stay post-pandemic for sure.
I want to shift gears a little bit to talking about sort of the role of the Canadian government in fueling some of this innovation. And, you know, Julian, obviously you mentioned that scale is supported by the government of both Canada and Quebec. Roger, I'd love to hear from you if you're back with us about more about how the Canadian government is involved, what they're doing to fuel innovation, what the strategy there is. We may have lost Roger again. Julian, yeah,
you need to call Roger.
Julian, do you want to take a crack at that one, just in terms of what you see from the government?
Yeah. So what's very important in Canada for you to understand is all levels of government are all aligned together to deliver value. Meaning, and that's very important. There's no competition. Most or all programs are both supported by the federal government, most of provincial governments, municipalities. So everybody is really putting all their effort to sustain typically the AI ecosystem. So it's true in Edmonton, it's true in Toronto, it's true in Montreal. And that's, I think that's quite unique. If you come from other countries, typically or other in Europe, it's hard to see so much concentration of efforts to really bring together a great ecosystem. So in our case, KLAI, as I said, was supported. 80% of our funding went from the federal government, but 20% came from the government of Quebec. We have great relationship also locally with all the organization in Montreal to bring more support. And I think this alignment, everybody recognize AI is key. There's a great opportunity for the country and a lot of tools to welcome you and basically at every level, everywhere in the country.
Sam.
Sam, you're on mute.
You're muted, Sam.
Sam, you're muted. Thank you. I'm curious to hear from Tom and Chloe as you're talking to companies that you work with about sort of some of the benefits of A, expanding in general, and B, expanding to specific spaces. I mean, what are the factors that you consider and how do you advise people when they're looking at where to grow?
I think for us, it's really around talent. So there is a challenge in our industry that there's just not enough talent. There are not enough roboticists or AI folks with the experience. It's amazing how many times we get a large corporation to say, hey, we're going to start a new robotics division. And we want, you know, we're looking for a guy with 20 years experience in a particular field, maybe autonomous navigation, when that field has only been around for 10 years. So, you know, they're looking for talent that just doesn't exist. And I think Canada, there's so many focused areas in Canada. I mean, we heard about the Vector Institute, but U of T also has an amazing robotics institute. And you look at Montreal and what's going on in AI, but there's also in Quebec, there's CRVI, which is the, I'm going to forget the acronym, but I think it's the Canadian Robotics Vision and AI, but it's a tech transfer that helps companies understand what technology is being developed at universities and then transfers it out to potential startups. I think there's just a lot of very targeted support in Canada. While there's a lot of investment in the US, it tends to be broader. And so if you have a specific interest, I think you have a good opportunity to find it in Canada.
Yeah, and I guess for us, you know, we encourage our portfolio companies to think on a global scale about markets rather than just, you know, their local markets and the US industries. I think within our portfolio, the routing company is really the company that's embraced this aspect the most. They're building dynamic routing and vehicle management solutions for transit providers and actually spun out of MIT's Computer Science and Artificial Intelligence Laboratory. So it's been doing pilots not only in Houston and Washington State, but also in Scotland and Tasmania, where you know there are these dispersed populations that don't necessarily have you know scheduled bus routes towards all the different types of folks who would require public transit. And so Canadian provinces would be you know an excellent prospective market for them to expand to next. And I'm sure is on their list of future locations. We also have you know Zapata Computing, which was co-founded by a then professor at Harvard, who is now AI chair at the Vector Institute and is located in Toronto. So we do have you know these portfolio companies that are actively thinking about you know these global markets, Canada included in the UK primarily. But yeah, I think we're not specifically focused on Massachusetts as a total market size.
Chloe, were you talking about Jamel and Layla?
In terms of Zapata Computing?
No, the supply chain, the routing.
Is it Wise? Yeah, we're talking, so the routing company and James Cox is really the CEO now. So he's the one that I interface with most. But yeah, it's spun out of Daniela Ross's lab at CSAIL.
Got it. I want to ask about sort of some of the specific regions and cities in Canada that we've been talking about. You know, I've heard Toronto mentioned, obviously Vancouver. What's sort of the hottest city for AI innovation in Canada right now? What's up and coming? Vishal, you want to talk a little bit about your experience? You're in Vancouver. You want to talk a little bit about your experience there and what the city offers for people working on AI?
Sure. I think that there is a lot here. There's like an AI and BC society. There's a couple of sort of interest groups at UBC. However, I think it probably is not anywhere near what's available in Toronto or in like, I don't know, maybe Ontario more broadly because of the Lou and associated places and Montreal as well. So maybe Edmonton as well. So I think it's good here, but it's still fledgling in my estimation. So we're trying to be a part of that and growing it, of course. And we think that we can help in lots of different ways from our own expertise and maybe some of our insight. One thing that I heard somebody saying earlier was about patents in Canada. I think maybe that was you, Roger, if you can hear us. And that's one area where we have lots of expertise. So we hope to sort of be part of the growing of the AI community in Vancouver. But I think as it stands today, I would suggest that the East Coast is doing a much better job. Maybe that's just a volume or numbers game though.
Yeah, Roger, if you're back with us, I'd love to hear from you about sort of some of the different regions of Canada and cities in Canada and where AI innovation is happening and where it's growing and where it might be happening next.
Well, we've taken an approach, the government's taken an approach because typically in a land so vast as Canada, it's usual that if there's a program out there that everybody wants a little bit of it. And so the benefits are sort of sprinkled across the country and does it really accomplish what it was sort of set out? Do you end up getting that critical mass? And so with the superclusters approach to developing various sectors, we have an oceans and marine sector in Halifax, for example. In the AI sector, we've looked at Edmonton, Toronto, Montreal, and we focused our our efforts in those cities. But there, you know, there are other natural things taking place in other centers as well, Vancouver. But they tend to sort of cluster, a natural clustering. You know, gaming has been something that's been really popular, and it's really grown in Vancouver and Montreal. We don't see as much of it in Toronto or some of the other centers. But and again, the thing that I think that's really common, you probably talked about it during the 20 minutes that I didn't have an audio feed, but just that we've been able to attract that talent, that skill level, and the talent attracts other talent. Some of these, you know, the best and the brightest, they want to work in those environments and, you know, work alongside some of the, you know, some of their peers. And we've made it easier to come to Canada and settle in Canada. And, you know, some of them have started new lives. And I think that over the last 4 or 5 years, that's become more and more evident. And I would think that you folks have talked about that already. I guess I'm assuming, I shouldn't assume, but that's something that we're hearing back from those that are taking advantage of the programs that are out there. Carolyn McCaffrey is on the phone with us as well. And Carolyn, would you like to add anything to that?
Okay, so I don't know if you can hear me now. No, Roger, I think you summarized it very well. And I think the one thing that is really at the forefront of Canada's strategy is literally the pan-Canadian approach. So because of the vast country, Canada was actually one of the first ones to really make it a strategic effort to support innovation. And that includes AI, but obviously not just AI. But I think previous remarks elaborated already very well. Julia, you did it. Tom, you said it. Vish, you said it. There is sort of a cluster effect that goes across the nation. So when you are looking at the innovation system, the talent that is available, or even, you know, other demands or needs that you have as a company, you will sort of align yourself with those clusters. And for some, and very simple example, for some, bilingual is very important when it comes to talent, when it comes to even customer orientation. So clearly, you know, Quebec would come to mind. And Julia, you are right there. You know that it's such a strong cluster there. At the same time, Vish had, an outlook for the West Coast. That's fine too, because the clusters there are extremely strong. So again, it really depends on where you're coming from. But from the government's perspective, we try to support those individual demands beyond just the pan-Canadian strategy and really make sure that we work with you to make it a sustainable fit. As a country, you know, we want to be at the forefront of the innovation, but we also want to make sure that you don't come in as a new startup, bring your two people and leave after 2 years. That is not what drives innovation. Innovation is something that is, you know, long-term, is really something that grows from within and builds an ecosystem. And I think that is where Canada really succeeds and has started in 2017 and is going very strong. And I know this comes out of my mouth, so obviously it's not as credible as it comes from someone else, but we do have Vish sort of as our best practice here today. And I think it's important for us that others can see where those opportunities lie, and that it goes from talent to tax credit, you name it, we'll try to work with you. But the innovation is really pan-Canadian. I hope that kind of answered a little bit of your questions, Sam.
Yeah, absolutely. And I want to follow up sort of about these clusters. What are the characteristics that make a good cluster for AI innovation? Obviously, you know, the academic connection, university proximity is important. You mentioned sort of bilingual areas as well, but what are some of the other sort of features of these clusters and why they've been successful? And that's for anyone here.
Can I just weigh in real quick? on that? Because I've been thinking about this for like a year and a half, especially going from Boston to Canada, or I guess it's been a year or whatever it's been. First of all, the bilingual we care about is basically Python and JavaScript, like English, whatever, you know. The cluster piece in Boston, there's this really great guy named Rob May. And there's many others like him. I don't know, maybe you guys know Rob as well. And one thing that he does, hopefully still happening, is every like 8 weeks or so, he would book out like maybe 23 Bar and Grill or like some place downtown and host like an AI dinner. And what he would do is, so he'd book the whole place out, so it's kind of very generous, but he would invite a startup from either MIT or Harvard or the college, Boston College or whatever. And they would do a presentation on whatever it was that they were building. And then the whole community there, there's about 50 people all having like a beautiful meal, would be all folks who were AI leaning or experts in some field or another. And everybody would listen to their presentation and then help them to improve whatever it is that they were working on, or just ask sort of thought-provoking questions. And then there was about an hour of networking and mingling amongst the attendees. And I thought that that was like the best example of building an enduring community that I've like ever seen, like not even just AI related. And so I think that is literally the thing I miss the most about Boston, because I haven't found anything that exists, at least here. So, I mean, I'd love to be able to just be like, all right, we're booking out the whole of like, whatever, the Fairmont and doing this thing. And being in person isn't necessarily the solution, but as long as we find a way to assemble and grow the community from within, kind of like what Carolyn was saying, then I think we can build something really enduring. Right now, I think there's a lot of fragmentation and a lack of cohesion, at least on the West Coast. And I think that's going to hold us back from creating a really enduring community, which is kind of a shame when we have the technologies that we do today.
Let's go to Julian and then Chloe.
Well, I mean, what you say, Vishal, is very important. I would say there are two things to build a great community. One is, we call it the triangle at Scale AI. And the triangle is at the top, fundamental research. One of the point is industry, and the other one is startups. And you have to create the glue between these three important pieces. Obviously, you can need to have people to fund projects like we do at Scale AI, but creating this glue is important. And what you say, Vishal, is great, because actually you cannot create the glue if there's not great personalities or human belonging in the ecosystem. And typically the Montreal ecosystem was created because you had Pierre Boivin and Hélène Desmarais all working together to create this ecosystem. And they hosted multiple dinners, multiple interactions. They really focused on building the glue between research, industry, startups. And basically that created the ecosystem. So you have to have the mechanics, the triangle, on the links in the triangle, but you have to also have a sense of community that people want to work together. And in Creative Destruction Lab is a great example. You have 50 mentors in every room to help startups. In Montreal, we have one in AI, one in supply chain, and these people do that for free. They really do that for help, and I can tell you they are a great community to help and build the ecosystem. So I think both are important.
Yeah, and to really build on some of these ideas, you know, prior to my role here at the Engine, I worked on innovation cluster research at Research. And specifically worked with a lot of battery companies and clusters there as well. And we identified six main areas that really make a strong innovation cluster. So that would be, you know, industry presence. Is there a market for these different technologies? Supportive policies, culture of innovation, finance, is there capital available? Infrastructure like that public transit infrastructure provided by the routing company, and then human capital, so these talent pools of really excellent people. And the best innovation clusters are specialized to target a particular window within the innovation funnel. So discovery, deployments, or, you know, launching a company and commercializing. And so, you know, here at the Engine, we care most about that really early stage of the innovation funnel, the research clusters. And I think for AI in Canada specifically, that's really what we see, you know, being strongest within Canada for the AI communities are these really extremely strong superclusters for AI research. And so that's really how we think of Canada and the Toronto and Waterloo and all of these really excellent innovation centers. But I think leveraging all six of those areas and culture has come up particularly within this particular panel, but understanding that it's really all six of those working together to build a supercluster, and that it's not just one particular organization that defines what a cluster is really crucial for continuing to grow these groups.
Switching gears a little bit, I want to ask about what is the hardest part of starting or expanding an AI company to Canada? And how are you, those of you who work on that, how are you helping companies you know, address that? Is it the geographical logistics? Is it some of the border stuff we talked about? Is it understanding the culture of Canada? What are some of the challenges that you've noticed from American or Boston companies specifically expanding to Canada, and how have you worked on that?
I'm happy to start just from a startup perspective. For us, we came over with like a small group of sort of our Boston staff. So there's about three or four of us. And we kind of like the complicating factor here is like, I don't know what's normal because we came over like in the middle of 2020 or like end of 2020 or whatever. And we actually set up a subsidiary in January, like this past January. And so it's possible that it's way easier than we experienced, right? In order to get plugged in and everything like that. But we really had to work hard to establish all of the relationships with the different you know, programs at UBC and AI and BC and the different communities. But I think it's not so much a factor of, I'd love Carolyn's input here actually, McCaffrey, but I think it's not so much a factor of it's actually difficult to do, but instead it's like, what are the circumstances around it? So I think it's more fair to ask Carolyn about this one from the startup perspective.
Yeah, no, I'm happy to answer that a little bit. And I think my answer is different now than it would have been before the pandemic. So to confirm Vish what you said, obviously things have shifted a little bit. But that is not AI specific. That's really something that goes across any company, be it a startup or a multinational. We all had to look at different ways to do business. So for the government of Canada, it is extremely important to us to support the companies where they are at. And as you can imagine, it really depends on, are you a startup with two people or are you a multinational with, you know, global operations and in 20 different countries? Your perspective will be very different, even when it comes to AI. So for us, we have sort of taken a consulting position, if you will call it that, meaning we listen very carefully to what the needs of our companies are and where we can support. To be quite frank, when it comes to money, it is very hard to compete with incentives that a US hands out to companies. We're very aware of that. Meaning we have to be strong in other areas, and that's where we're trying to focus. So we work across all three levels of government, federal, provincial, and municipal, to support the companies coming in. That can include anything from support programs, including financial incentives, tax credits, SHRED, our R&D incentive program that is very beneficial for companies that focus in the innovation realm. But it's also something as simple as cost effectiveness that we're able to identify together with the companies. We do benchmark studies. We can compare a location in Nova Scotia, no pun intended here, Roger. I know you're very high on Nova Scotia, but sometimes that's not a good fit for people. Just because it's cheap, inexpensive, doesn't mean that it also has the talent that companies are looking for. So we're really very careful in the support that we're handing out. And we're also working very, very closely with our partners across the country. So for Vish, for example, he knew he would be locating in BC. We have actually a BC representative here in Boston who we then work with, partner with, to connect to those companies and make sure that they activate their network of service providers, legal, tax, you name it, recruiters. Again, so you started me. I can tell you a lot of things. I apologize. But it's really a very complex catalog of people, connections, programs, incentives that we offer and that we try to really align with the decision process that the company is going through. And now I'm going to shut up. I apologize. It's a topic I can talk about all day long.
No, we really appreciate your insights and we're glad you're here. We have a couple minutes left. I want to ask each of our panelists to give in 30 seconds, which I know is a challenge, but give your advice to anyone on the call who is looking at expanding to Canada in the field of AI. So 30 seconds, let's start with Julian.
Well, I would say talent is the key. And if you want to expand to Canada and look about and think about AI, you will go there, you will go to Canada because you will find a lot of talent, relatively cheap talent comparing to Silicon Valley typically. So you can go there because a lot of talents, a lot of great research, a lot of good students, a lot of good engineers, a relatively affordable cost of life. So you will definitely go there because you can find great possibility of expansion with talent.
Vish, your 30-second advice for anyone looking to follow in your footsteps.
Set up the subsidiary. If you have the ability to set it up as a Canadian entity, then you should make sure that you do that properly because it vastly expands the amount of SR&ED credits that you can be eligible for. So that's something we really are fortunate to have done. And then the other thing is make sure that you network with other founders in the area who are in the AI space because they will be the strongest backbone for you as you sort of forge ahead in the new country.
Tom, what about you?
So I'm going to piggyback off something Vishay said is that networking, which is critically important. And one of the things that nobody from the Canadian side talked about on this side, primarily because it's focused on connecting with the Boston ecosystem, but the Canadian Consulate runs the CTA, which is the Canadian Technology Accelerator. They have amazing insight into the clusters that are really strong here in Boston. And so obviously it's not quite going into Canada, but the same way if you're a Canadian company looking to understand how to get into the cluster or the network, maybe in life sciences or robotics that's in Boston, just work with them and they have amazing connections. And I'm sure that's true in the provinces as well.
So we'll do Chloe and then finish with Roger with 30 seconds of advice each.
Yeah, I think on my side, making sure that you have those local connections is super important, but being sure that you're not just becoming a satellite branch of your company is also super critical. You want to maintain those relationships within your, whether it's your home office or your parent company, to make sure that you're all still aligned and pursuing the same goals.
Let me first thank Tom for filling in on the CTA and the great work that gets done there and the the great connections that are made out of that as well, Tom. So thank you for that. But Noel, come to Canada for the talent and the opportunity. Stay for the poutine and maple syrup. It's we want to do business as Carolyn had indicated. There's not a one size fits all, but we want to work with companies to make sure that they're aware of what's to their avail and do the best we can to help them succeed in a move to Canada. So listen, this has been fabulous. I'll look forward to going back and listening to the recording and picking up on that 20 minutes that I've, it's almost like, retrospective of the pandemic, go back and look at the last year and a half that you lost. But this has been fabulous. And the partnering with Carolyn and Megan has been top shelf. Sam, great job on the moderating. Thanks very much for partnering with us today.
Yeah, thank you all so much. We are out of time. Thanks again to all of you for joining us this morning, for all of your insight and knowledge. It's greatly appreciated. I want to thank again the Consulate for partnering with us on such a great discussion. We really appreciate it. Thanks, Roger. And thanks to everyone who joined us in the audience. If you missed any of the discussion or if you want to rewatch it post-event, keep an eye out. We'll have a thank you email coming with access later today. And we hope you all have a great afternoon. We'll see you at a future event. And yeah, please keep following our work at Bostino and The Beat, which is our daily newsletter. Megan sent out a link to sign up for that before. It's a great way to keep up with everything we're writing. And that's all we have. So thank you all so much for joining us.